We are all happy that COVID vaccines are here. A better future is on the horizon. But just how far out is that horizon? Will Canada get vaccines in a timely manner? Are some people more likely to catch COVID and to die? Should we be worried about the virus mutating? Why isn't Canada making vaccines as many other countries are? I invited City Councillor and medical historian Jaimie McEvoy to answer some of these questions, starting with, why has Canada fallen short when it comes to making vaccines?
Well, there's a couple of things there. One is that some of the vaccine was actually developed in Canada, right? What's being called the Pfizer vaccine is actually developed in Germany by BioNTech, and Pfizer is sort of the owner and the marketer. Some of that was developed at UBC. I had a NewWestminster woman contact me who was really excited that one element of the virus, I think the study of how it's delivered to human beings, was developed in British Columbia. And from various countries, honestly, tens or in hundreds of millions of dollars to develop these vaccines from governments to try to get them developed as quickly as possible.
Well, that's exciting. I like that idea. Mm-hmm. But what about the actual manufacture of the vaccines here?
We used to be able to manufacture vaccines in Canada, and we don't have that capability anymore. We had 50 years ago, if you go back that far, Canada manufactured insulin, vaccine for diphtheria, polio, was influenza. Canada was a leading manufacturer of influenza vaccine up until 1989. And the major lab was Connaught Labs, which started through a university, became a private company, but it became a private company before nonprofits were common. It did not have a profit motive. It had a mandate to produce the vaccines, and it was eventually bought by the Canadian government, because the Canadian government of the day, which was 1972, wanted to make sure certain kinds of businesses still existed in Canada. In 1986, Brian Mulroney privatized Connaught Labs, and it sold and merged through a variety of pharmaceutical companies, and until Canada just doesn't have the capacity to manufacture vaccine anymore through that privatization.
Mm-hmm. I know it's kind of a hard story. I did read, however, there are a couple of vaccine makers here, one in Toronto, one in Quebec. Sanofi in Toronto and GlaxoSmithKline, but they make flu type vaccines, and they so far they don't have any capability of doing these more specialized vaccines that use RNA to impact the DNA. Have you heard about
Sanofi?
That?
Sanofi is actually the current owner of the former government lab in Canada, and It has a very small manufacturing capacity here and a very narrow manufacturing capacity. So it doesn't have the ability to simply set up new labs and production to produce a new kind of vaccine, which is unfortunate. But both in terms of scale and ability, the capacity to produce COVID vaccines just isn't there. There are some companies that. To give Trudeau some credit, there's hundreds of millions of dollars have gone out from the federal government to some companies that are seeking to set up manufacturing in Canada, but it turns out that that's not something that can be done quickly. It's complicated, and we're probably looking at 2022 for any kind of large-scale vaccine manufacturing in Canada.
Well, I mean, best to get it started, because it seems to me with this global situation and increasing population and increasing contact between animals and people, these pandemics are not going to be once in a century, would be my guess. I don't know what your thoughts are there.
You know, as someone who's written a medical history, I wasn't surprised at all that we had a worldwide pandemic, even though there had been containment of the last few, like SARS, I wasn't surprised because the health measures just kind of aren't there. And the pandemic readiness really wasn't there. I mean, there's sort of government contingency plans. Some of them were very old. We're really fortunate that it didn't overwhelm our hospitals because we weren't carrying a lot of excess hospital supply in the world, you know. The government made a really good decision in British Columbia to limit elective surgeries, which was hard on a lot of people, but it freed up hospital beds to ensure that we could still cope with the crisis.
Mm-hmm. Now, what ultimately, when Connaught Labs got privatized, who owns it now? I mean, it's probably gone through a few ownerships or mergers or something. I don't know.
Yeah, it's complicated, the mergers and ownership that have happened, but it is now owned by Sanofi.
Oh, okay, only Sanofi. But as you say, it was a nonprofit, and I know that the scientists behind it were very much, community minded, public minded, mm-hmm. and they wanted to sell their vaccines at a very reasonable cost. Profit making wasn't their main one. What's the situation now? Are people paying way more? Are we paying a lot in profit now for our vaccines?
I don't know the numbers on that, but nobody in Canada is producing vaccines for the purpose of it being low cost. And unfortunately, when Connaught Labs was sold to the federal government in 1972, these were people who had set up that lab to serve the common interest. And when they sold the lab to a government entity, part of the whole idea was that it would continue to serve the common good through that Canadian government ownership. Honestly, those pioneers of medicine would be very sad that to see how it works today.
Is there anything that you would find that you think people might find interesting about that vaccine capability here and so on?
I'll mention a couple of things, see if you can use them. But some countries that have some capacity were able to negotiate to have quicker access to more vaccine by negotiating to have the vaccines made in their own country. Canada couldn't even do that because we just don't have a place where that could have happened. So Canada is sort of on the international market for purchasing vaccines through a U.S. company. Very soon there'll be vaccines coming out of the U.K. and Germany. But Canada didn't even have a place where it could try to have negotiated some production. Companies that are trying to set this up. One is a Canadian company, Medicago, I think it's pronounced. It's a Canadian company. They're not going to have production ready until 2024. Mm-hmm. So, and there are some doctors and scientists out of Toronto calling for a crown corporation to be set up to produce vaccines in Canada.
Well, I think that's a good idea. In fact, it's kind of one of my pet peeves in life is that the government should be setting up other crown corporations for other, things that need to be done, like getting the whole technology for climate change kickstarted big time. What about, that terrible story about the Shermans being murdered and Mr. Sherman had a large vaccine company. Although I think at the time that they were murdered, that he was about to move down to Florida, are they still in existence, or could they have played a part in all of this?
I don't think they could have. No, mm-hmm. It's just not been possible to start from zero and make things happen. I know a little bit about the Shermans. I think they had good intentions, but any sort of recent manufacturing of vaccines in Canada has been done along really narrow lines, where they might be able to produce one particular kind of vaccine in small numbers.
Do you feel like Canada's supply of vaccine for COVID is a little bit at risk because we don't make our own, so that a country can kind of push and say, well, you know, sorry, you're not going to send those vaccines over to Canada. We're going to keep them here.
It is a little bit at risk. So Canada has contracts with vaccine companies, but those contracts don't have a delivery date. They kind of have an estimated range, which is what you hear people from Dr. Henry to Trudeau talk about timelines. That's what they're talking about. But the contracts don't have any specified dates to deliver. So there's a bit of a risk. So in British Columbia, for example, the decision has been made to use all of the vaccines that have currently arrived and not to save any for the second dose. I don't remember when the second dose is required, but if people don't get the second dose in time, then it has to start over. So there's been a presumption that more vaccine will arrive in time for those second doses for those high priority people.
I was talking to our MP, Peter Gillian, and he, mm-hmm. I mean, his idea is, or his understanding is that the flow of these vaccines into Canada is going to be much slower than what we're being told. Do you know anything about that?
Well, that's entirely possible. There's so much we don't know about these vaccines. We don't know the rate of production. We don't know that at all. That hasn't been public information. We're only hearing estimates from government. We don't know what governments everywhere. We don't know what those estimates are based on, right? So, but there is some potential good news out there. The Moderna vaccine has initially required deep refrigeration. It doesn't now. So we're using Pfizer, which requires the deep refrigeration, which means a limited ability to deliver in a very limited infrastructure. But Moderna doesn't require that. The Oxford vaccine, which will probably be produced soon, doesn't require any kind of refrigeration. And it's one of the cheapest. It's at $1 a dose for the Oxford vaccine. You know, for Pfizer, it varies by country, but it can get up to $10, $11, $12 per dose. So the thing about the Oxford vaccine is it's only 70% effective at last testing, but 70% effectiveness has actually been considered pretty good for vaccines, right? It's a pretty high ratio of the public that if they get inoculated, that would be protected. And that really does help to protect the other 30%. And the Oxford vaccine is probably the most important to the world because it's the one that can be delivered in developing countries that don't have that refrigeration structure and need to pay a cheaper price.
Well, certainly we've heard that it's very useful, particularly in some of the Indian reserves north, in the north, which are very remote. Mm-hmm. Although it's kind of worrisome because some reserves, it's so widespread already that COVID that there's almost to the point that they don't need vaccines because they've all had COVID.
Well, I can tell you the worst hit area in the United States is the Navajo Indian Reservation.
Oh, really?
Yeah, which has had many deaths, hundreds of cases. That's really a mixed story because a lot of First Nations communities have effectively tried to close themselves off or educated people about the needs. But, you know, COVID loves a crowd, right? That's why it spread in old age homes. And when you look at how crowded some of the housing conditions are on Canada's reservations, you know, in my house, if one of us got COVID, one other person would be exposed, right? In a situation where there's poverty and lack of housing, there might be many people just within that house who could be exposed, right? So it is a real problem.
There's a lot of people that seem to be more susceptible, like First Nations, like Blacks, like Hispanics, et cetera, mm-hmm. et cetera.
Is it all to do with crowding, do you think, or is it also to do with some sort of genetic makeup? Do you have any knowledge about that?
Yeah, the honest answer is we don't know for sure yet. They did a study in Britain when it became to be obvious that people of Black and South Asian descent had higher ratios of catching COVID. One of the surprises out of the first study was that wasn't necessarily tied to genetics. It wasn't every group of every social class. And so then the question was, is there a genetic basis for this? That's still being studied further, or is it more about who the people are in society who are more likely to be poor? It's still somewhat an unanswered question.
Mm-hmm. Because certainly there's populations that are much more susceptible to things like hypertension and diabetes and so on. Mm-hmm. And it seems to be a genetic issue. So it will be very interesting to find out ultimately.
I can tell you that in the United States, Black people who wound up in COVID with hospital were still twice as likely to die.
Mm-hmm. Also in the States, though, that there's quite a difference between hospitals. There's kind of the hospitals that cater to the rich and then there's hospitals that are there for people that don't have any money. So that may be another factor, do you think?
Yeah, There's different sources in America. I actually feel sorry for people trying to sort some of this out. You know, you might read a doctor said something, but that doctor turns out to be a member of a Republican Party group that's made up of 1,000 doctors, and their priority is to be a Republican. So, really getting the sort of the good information, like what's published, what's peer reviewed, what's published in the Lancet, things like that is difficult. The hospitals themselves, there are statistics out of New York State, for example, that show that certain demographic groups seem to have been much slower to get medical help or go to hospital than other demographic groups did. What is not typically analyzed in any sort of American research papers that I've looked at, though, is whether poverty was a factor in that.
Mm-hmm. Now, what about willingness to have a vaccine in BC? Is there any kind of knowledge about what percentage of people are won't take it at all, and those who are sort of iffy about it?
There's about two-thirds of British Columbians in polling who've said they're ready now to take the vaccine, you know. The other one-third, it's not clear how many are absolutely committed to not taking the vaccine. I suspect that a majority will. You know, there is some past history with the medical establishment that people read about and are influenced by. There is, in the United States, for example, there's a history with Black people in medicine that has left a lasting legacy of suspicion. So I think that there's probably a large crowd of people who want to wait and see a little bit, right? And as people see that, there's already posting of people who've gotten the vaccine, there are news stories, they're posting online, they're showing it. As more and more people get the vaccine, I think that will help people to find their way. And as we know the problems with it, we know now that if you have severe allergies, to the extent that you carry epinephrine, you probably shouldn't get this vaccine. So, as the months go by, because it is going to be many, many months, we'll see more people having the vaccine. We'll see more people knowing about it. At the end of the day, there will be some people who just refuse to get the vaccine. There might be consequences for that, right? There was a ruling I think the ruling was in Ontario, where an employer refused advised employees if they don't get the vaccine, they will not be returning to work, right? They won't be allowed in the workplace is what was decided. And there's already been a human rights complaint just about that employer's ruling, and the ruling was no, that's a reasonable infringement on your human rights, and it's the employer's responsibility to protect the other workers. So do you want to take a plane flight? and you're the one who's not vaccinated, right? So but I think the large majority of people will want to take this vaccine. I think it'll surpass the hoped for minimum of 70% fairly easy in BC. And it's going to roll out in a way where you're going to be offered your chance, you know? And it probably won't be that everyone is told they can go to their doctor now. You know, it's more likely that it will go through certain populations in society. They'll be contacted by the doctors, or they'll be advised in news stories that they're now eligible. And when people are in that position where they have to decide, okay, I can get the vaccine now, am I going to refuse to do that? Or am I going to get it while I have the chance? I think an awful lot of people want to return to normal life. And for anti-vaxxers, I hope that authorities are thoughtful and compassionate, and really focus just on the question of this vaccine for COVID, whether it's the mRNA vaccine or it's dead vac or it's dead virus. There's different types that will be out there. People wait long enough, they'll have a choice of which type they might feel better with, or their doctor might feel better with. But I think that people are going to lean very heavily towards wanting to get vaccinated.
Well, let's hope. Now, for measles, for example, what percentage of people do not have the measles vaccination? Because we've seen these little outbreaks, so I'm just wondering, yeah, how does this compare to the hope for 70% plus?
The measles vaccine is typically administered in schools, so it captures almost everybody. There are a few private schools of a particular ideological bent or belief system where there have been measles outbreaks. When you read about a measles outbreak in Fraser Health, it's typically actually at a single location where there was some kind of belief system objection to taking the vaccine.
Okay. And what about messaging around taking vaccines? What do you think about the messaging here in Canada, and I guess BC in particular? Are you, are they just still really in formulation stage?
You know, when I get my vaccine, whenever that is, I know I'm going to post a selfie. I actually think government and media are going to do a good job. I think they already are, of explaining the vaccines, how they work, the different types. At some point, we'll start to have statistics on side effects, which will give people real and honest information, right? Which is what people want. They want to, for people who have some doubts or some concerns, even about their own health, they want to have some real information to evaluate. And I think that's sort of the sensible and compassionate way to go about that, is actually respect people's desire to be well-informed and to be able to have confidence.
It sounds to me like you have this huge background in medical history. I find it very fascinating.
When I wrote my book about St. Mary's Hospital, that was actually a four-year project, right? It was just 2 years of hard research about medical history in British Columbia. And I actually worked with the St. Mary's Health Foundation and worked with some medical people, particularly Dr. Irwin Stewart, who is no longer with us, but really served as a kind of medical advisor on the book, because sometimes I couldn't actually describe the history without actually understanding the disease, right? Mm-hmm. I'm willing to bet I'm the only person in New West who's read the Encyclopedia of Plagues and Diseases. And I, I have a good capacity to remember what I read, and I actually do like to read scientific papers and sort of get at that level of understanding. So,
well, I guess, what did I read? I read that tuberculosis has killed more people in the world than anything else. Is that your knowledge?
In all time?
In all time. In all time.
Yeah, I don't know about that. There's some some really early plagues that we don't know much about, and don't understand the history of. There was a plague called Justinian's Plague, when Justinian was the emperor of the Eastern Roman Empire. And it seemed to be a particularly very devastating disease, but it's not from a time when they were keeping statistics, right?
Right, yeah.
And, and then there's cofactors, and tuberculosis is one of those diseases that sometimes takes advantage of other diseases and ailments of the body.
Uh-huh. Fascinating. Well, I'll have to get my hands on your book somehow. I'd like to read it. Do they have it in the library?
They do have it in the library, yeah, and it's available through Harbor Publishing.
Oh, okay. Is it called St. Mary's Hospital?
It's called The Life and Destruction of St. Mary's Hospital.
Oh, okay. Uh-huh. Okay, I'll look that up. Okay, well, Jaimie, thank you so much for once again enlightening us.
Yeah, thank you. It's fun.
It's fun to meet you.
As much as this can be a fun topic.
Right. Well, curious minds, almost anything is interesting fun. Right. Okay, you take care. Have a good evening and say hi to Stacy.